it fits in your room, if it matches the colors. And I mean, like, do you see how realistic this looks? Hey, Jan here, welcome back to Coding with Jan. And today I want to show you how you can use some 3D product models and even some features for augmented reality on your store so that customers could even test the product at home before actually buying it. And I think this might be super interesting to anyone who's selling furniture, decor, maybe even mechanical parts. And by the way, I never told you, but I have an educational background in engineering. And yes, I'm really that much German. But anyways, let's get into the video and have some fun. All right, so here's the outline for today. I think first of all, I want to give you a small intro to the newer types of product media, so just that you and I get on the same track. And then we can actually upload a 3D model to the store, put it to the test and demonstrate all the features. And I think during the process, I can also share my thoughts on when they might be useful and when they might lead to an increase of conversions. And in the end, I have a few tips for you when it comes to 3D model acquisition, because I'm quite sure not everyone has a 3D product model laying around on the hard drive. So let's get started. Okay, first of all, one thing that many people don't know about, but Shopify actually lets you upload videos in the MOV and MP4 format or 3D models in the GLB format directly to the product page. And since the section now features different types of media and is no longer limited to images only, it is currently referred to as the product media. Now, one thing that I have to mention is that as the feature is still relatively new, you would either need to use a modern theme or you would need to make some code modifications to an older theme just in order to handle these different types of media. And for instance, the debut theme is capable of handling these 3D files since it's version 16. And if you're not quite sure which one you're using, you can just go to the action button and then edit code. And this will bring up the theme file editor. And we are looking for a file that is called settings_schema. It is located within the config folder. And right on top, we could read the theme version. And I'm using 16.5. And if you're using a completely different theme, but you still want to find out if your theme is capable of handling these files, then you could either just test it out, or you could try to find the code snippet that makes up your product gallery. And most likely you will find that in the product template. And you can see in more modern themes, they loop over every media object in the product media, and then they do stuff with it. And in older themes, like in debut version 13, they would only loop over the product images, and they don't even look for any product media. So this might be a good indicator as well. All right, so now comes the fun part where we actually upload a 3D model and test and play around with it to demonstrate all the features. And you can see that I have a GLB file on my computer and I can just drag and drop it to the media section and then it gets uploaded and processed automatically. And as I said in the beginning, we will talk about file acquisition later on. This one has been provided by Shopify. But one thing that I can already tell you is that the file size can't exceed 15 megabytes. And for instance, this one has 2.5 megabytes, just to give you a feeling for that. But as long as you stay below the 15, I think you're fine. And now that the file is uploaded, we can already see how it looks on the front end. So here we have the 3D model, and you can see I can drag and drop it around. And actually on the screen recording, it seems like it's lagging a bit behind, but in my browser window, it's like super smooth. And we can view it from all the different angles, and you would even see the light reflection. So how awesome is that? And what we can also do is zoom in and zoom out to get a feeling for what kind of material is used, or we could even understand how the system is mounted. So this is already a fantastic way for your customers to get familiar with the product. And now let me show you what the same page looks like on a smartphone, and this is where things get really interesting. So now I actually went ahead and created the screen recording on my phone. And at first glance, it might seem like the product page is very similar to the desktop version. I mean, we have the 3D model and you can rotate it around, see it from all perspectives. You can even zoom in and zoom out like we saw on the desktop version. But what is really, really special about this view is that we have this view in space button. And once you click that, it would launch the augmented reality core on your phone. So if we click on that, it would immediately bring up the camera and pop the object into existence. And then you can place it within your room. And once you lock it, you can literally walk around the object and see it from all the different perspectives and see if the object fits in your room, if it matches the colors. And I mean, like, do you see how realistic this looks like? How amazing can things get? So to me, this is just mind-blowing. And to me, as a technical enthusiast, it gets even more amazing if you think about all the calculations that take place, because the camera has to capture all the images and then they need to get processed in some way that they can extract distinct reference points. And then it takes the gyroscopic data from your phone to render the 3D model from the right perspective. And that all happens in real time. And we're not talking about some fancy supercomputer. No, it's just your smartphone of the size that you can put it in your pocket. I mean, think about that. And then I also wanted to see if I could sit on my new imaginary desk and maybe pretend to type something. So here's the footage of that. And you can see that sometimes it glitches a bit if I grab into the model, but you could also see that, for instance, the table leg in the back is hidden when I occupy it. So overall, I would say this works super well. Now, before we get into my tips on 3D model acquisition, let me give you a few ideas and considerations why having these in the first place might be a good idea. And here I have to admit that these are just my personal beliefs and thoughts. I don't have any actual data to back these up, which is something that I usually prefer. And yes, I'm really that much German. But anyways, let's get into the top benefits. So consideration number one is all about increasing the conversion rate. And I think especially in e-commerce, if there are any uncertainties regarding a product, it can easily prevent the user from actually buying. And it makes sense. Everyone wants to make the right decision. No one wants to buy a product that doesn't meet his or her expectations. And I think these 3D models are a great way to interact with the product, get familiar with the product, and already inspect it. And that immediately brings us to consideration number two, which is lowering the return rates. For pretty much the same reason, now the customer's already familiar with the product and he had opportunity to test it in his room, see if everything fits, if the colors match. And I think this just helps to set the right expectations. Consideration number three is about if you're selling high ticket items, because I think these 3D models on a product page suggest higher product quality and it might help. The last consideration is about engagement on your site, because for me it was a lot of fun to play around with these augmented reality features, and I even showed this to some of my friends. So I think this is a great way to boost engagement on your site. Now finally, we can talk about 3D model acquisition. So let's see a few different ways how one could approach that. So the two most important things to keep in mind are that the product file needs to be in the .glb format and the file size cannot exceed 15 megabytes. So regardless of which of the following ways you use, you will definitely need product images from all the relevant perspectives, and you would also need to label them. And then you would need measurements or provide measurements in a structured way so that you can have a true size model of your product. And actually, Shopify has a great help article on this, and I will definitely link it down in the video description. Now, the first and most likely the easiest way to obtain a product model for yourself would be handing off the task to a Shopify expert. And actually, you can filter the experts marketplace for creation of 3D models for augmented reality. But as I haven't worked with any of these agencies myself, I can't really recommend any in particular, and you would have to make your own experience here. But most likely they're going to be using some of the more common 3D modeling softwares, which include Blender and Photoshop. Maybe you heard of some of these. And this directly brings us to option number two, which is the do-it-yourself approach. Because for most of these programs, you can find very detailed tutorials online for free. And if your product is not too complex, you might even be able to get decent results in a few hours or maybe in a day or two. And that would be completely for free. Your third option would be to find an expert in any of these programs. And that could even be outside the Shopify ecosystem. So for instance, on Fiverr, you could search for Photoshop or Blender. And here you would already find a few gigs offering 3D modeling. And then you could discuss the requirements and maybe you can get a good deal there. Now, the fourth way to obtain a product model is only going to be interesting for people that already have their product model in some sort of computer-aided design software. And if you don't know, that's what engineers use to model their mechanical parts or more complex systems. And you can actually convert these files to the .glb format. And to be honest, I found this method to be a bit of a hassle because sometimes the conversion would fail and more often than not, I was losing all the color information. So here you can see I have some generated images and this is the model behind it. And now you would see it's completely colorless, but as the method is so cost-effective, if you already have these models ready to use in some sort of CAD system, I just didn't want to leave it out. All right, I think with that, we can bring this video to a close. And I really hope you had fun watching. Maybe you learned something new. And if you have questions, please leave them down in the comment section. I still try to answer as many as I can. And if you don't want to miss out on future content, feel yourself invited to subscribe to the channel. And then I really hope to see you in the next. Bye.